Good afternoon and welcome back. If you stuck around after that Duhok volleyball game, we are prepared for a very exciting women's basketball matchup between the Loras College Duhoks and the visiting Nebraska Wesleyan Prairie Wolves. I'm Adam Rodriguez. Joined alongside me is Hugh Molony. Hugh, how you doing today?
I'm doing amazing, Adam. I'm looking forward to watching two good games, this one and then the men's after. I'm looking forward to it.
Yep, definitely. These two teams met earlier in the year. Loras came away with a 91-43 victory. They're definitely going to look to repeat that. And as for Nebraska, they're probably going to look to flip that score around. Hugh, who are you looking at? Who are some key players for tonight for both teams?
Well, you know, obviously for the Duhok, it's Sammy Martin.
Absolutely.
That's what she's been since she's been here. She's transferring from Bradley. She's been that go-to player for the Duhoks coming into today, averaging 15.8 points and 7.5 rebounds, which is just an insane stat line. And then for the Prairie Wolves, I'm going to be looking at Brianna Denton. She is tied for lead, for the team lead in points with 7.6, as well as second on the team in field goal percentage from the three-point line, 34.
Absolutely. You mentioned Sammy Martin averaging 15. She leads the conference in points scored, and that's a quick start for the Duhoks with Fleck getting on the board. Here, you want to go through tonight's starting lineups?
Yeah, starting with the Duhoks, at point guard, we got number 5, Sierra Bachman, and number at center, we got number 11, Sammy Martin, number 13, Daniela Jarrell, number 24, Madison Haslau. And for the Duhoks, the last one, number 35, Madison Fleckenstein.
Definitely. Duhoks starting off strong in this press, making the Prairie Wolves really move a lot quicker than what they want to. Already forced a turnover. Martin going to go to work down low, and there's a bucket. Now for the Prairie Wolves, who you got, Hugh?
For the Prairie Wolves, we got Brianna Denton, number 1. Number 10, Tessa Skelton. Number 23, Ellie Bream. Number 34, Avery Holiday. And number 40, Anna Van Denek.
So here we go. Prairie Wolves, their first possession at their own pace here. They're just moving around the top of the key pretty well. Prairie Wolves coming into tonight's or this afternoon's game with a overall 6-15 record and a 2-11 conference record. And as for the Duhoks, they're coming in tonight with an 18-4 record and an impressive 11-2 conference record and 10-1 at home. Oh, they really love playing in front of their crowd and their students.
Yeah, they've been a pleasant team to watch all year long. It's almost like a well-oiled machine, especially at home, like you said, only one loss. So I expect nothing else from this game today.
Absolutely, and if you're a Loras fan, you kind of expected this out of this squad, only losing really two key players in Sydney Schuler and Jamie Ryan from last year's squad, returning almost pretty much everyone. Say you would almost expect them to have this kind of season. Rel for three, that's good.
Yeah, that was a good find by Fleckenstein. Mm-hmm. They crashed in off the corner, excuse me. And Jarrell is only that was only her 23 attempt of the year, so definitely the scouting report said she won't shoot it, and then she made a pay there.
Yeah, and Jarrell definitely good. That's a good three there from Prairie Wolves. It's a good hit by number 10, Skelton. Yeah. Jarrell, you didn't really see much action from her early in the season, but then towards like the middle and later parts of this year, that's when Coach Heinsohn really started moving her into the lineup. You saw a lot of Scarcella throughout the beginning, and now you kind of see more Jarrell than you do Scarcella. You still see Scarcella, but DJ really earning her time.
Yeah, and
year.
I think part of that was because she also is on the soccer team as well, and they made a run in the tournament like they did the season before. So I think that also played a fact into her not playing as much as she is right now.
Yep. Cassie Morozik's going to check in for the first time tonight. She's going to come in for Fleckenstein. Martin knocks down that first one. That foul was called on Ellie Bream. Duhok still keeping this pressure up. Seems to be working so far, making the Prairie Wolves really speed up.
Yeah, I think the Duhoks are going to have to watch number 5 out there now for the Prairie Wolves. Ellie Barrows leads the team in three-point shot attempts with 135. So she's not afraid to let it fly.
Yep,
she does right there.
Just long. It's going to be out of bounds and Duhok ball. Fleck's going to come back in. She's going to come in or Urell, and Wittenball is going to come in for her first time, coming in for Haslow.
Yeah, Wittenball, I believe, did start a few games last year with some injuries, and now she's coming off the bench. But definitely, only as a sophomore, though, definitely has a lot of poise on her with how much she played last year.
Yeah, definitely. And Fleck, I mean, she's just a unit down low. She's a force to reckon with down in the paint. Duhosh got a fast break. Martin's going to give that up to Fleck, and Fleck, nice little left-handed lay.
Yeah, that was a good job by Sammy. She almost lost the ball there, but had enough poise on her not to get rattled, not to get running on herself there, and got it over.
Yep, it's going to be a...
As it looks like.
It's going to be a timeout by...
Wesleyan, I believe. Just looked like Coach Hines was a little confused on something.
Squad's getting ready to break their huddle. Duhok's leading 11-3. Duhok's are coming off of a pretty impressive win, a 79-50 win over Luther, and they are currently riding a five-game win streak coming into today, looking to make that six. And as for Nebraska, they're coming off a 83-33 loss to Wartburg, and currently on a three-game skid, looking to turn that around today. Wittenball putting the pressure on in the backcourt. Nebraska gets it across. Barrows on that right wing.
Duhawks in man here. Looks like they're hedging the screen so far.
Green's three, no good, and that's a good rebound there from Davis. It's going to be last touch by Duhawks, and it's going to be a Nebraska ball.
And then you see Barrows once again. It's almost seemed like both times she's touched it, she just let it fly within like half a second.
Yep. And Urell checking back in. And Megan Murray making her first appearance today.
Should be Duhawk ball there, yeah. Good defense there by Jarrell.
Josh moving around. Urell at the top, looking for something to do with it. Finds Wittenball. Finds Murray. Murray thought about it, drove. It's a good idea, just a little miscommunication. Wasn't expecting Rosick to cut in. She thought she was going to stay out in that corner for a three.
Yeah, and I think the thing with Meg Murray is I don't think she's played as much as she thought she would this year. Only coming in today, she's only played 62 minutes in 13 games.
Mm-hmm.
So I think she's probably thought, because last year she was playing quite a bit.
Yep.
So definitely a struggle for her. Maybe trying to play perfect, and when you do that as a player, that's when you don't play perfect.
Yeah, and I mean, throughout this season, you saw a lot of Scarcella and Barrows again. Her three, no good. But this year we see a lot of Savannah, and she's just... Doesn't look like she's out there on the bench, so we probably will be seeing a lot more Murray here today.
Yeah, it's getting around that time of the year as Fleck shoots a three here. That, like, especially in college, kids are starting to get sick.
Yeah.
You know, allergies and stuff, so that could be why Scarcello is not on the bench. There's good defense here by the Duhawks. They're just swarming. That's got to be close to a five count.
Yeah, five count. There we go. Fleck with a steal. Baseball pass to Wittenball. Wittenball just dumps it down to Morozic, and she's got a layup.
Yeah, that's just your classic drill right there. You run in practice, almost like a three-man weave. But, I mean, you practice that and could show Duhawks weren't, you know, too antsy with it. They were patient.
Duhawks again keeping that pressure. It's going to be a reach on Fleck, and she knew it too.
I think it's on Meg Murr.
Oh, it's on Meg.
Yeah, she Murray did kind of grab the arm there. I thought they could have trapped her there if, you know, she would have got there a little bit sooner, not got in the way.
Yeah, and checking in for the Duhawks is Lexi Beyer. She came in for Morozik.
Holiday wants a clear out here. Yeah, oh, nice find the back.
Nice wraparound. Holiday's going to drive in with that left. Beyer on her, looking for somewhere to go with it.
It's good defense by the Duhawks.
Yeah, great defense. They're everywhere. A lot of good rotations here for the Duhawks early in this game.
Fleckenstein was really working down low that possession.
It's a dump down to Davis. They're going to call a foul on Wittenbaugh.
Yeah, Fleckenstein was banging down low there with Anna Vandenak, and maybe something to watch as she did kind of have a little bit of a mismatch down there height-wise, so Sammy checks in for her now.
Yeah, and Bachman will come in for Murray. Davis, first one, no good. Davis, a 45% shooter from the line. Second one, no good. Martin coming down with that rebound with ease. Sammy almost lost it there on the dribble. She's just going to kick it up to Jarrell.
Yeah, that's
good defense here from the Prairie Wolves.
Both times defense. Sammy's brought the ball down. She's kind of lost it on the dribble.
Yeah. Good move from Martin. That layup's no good. And Dave's going to come down with it.
Yeah, just a lack of focus there from Sammy. The defense wasn't anything too special or on or overly tight.
No.
And I think that's something she makes 90 out of 100 times.
Bachman cross pass to Urell. Wittenbaugh just a dribble in. Takes a nice little mid-range. She knocks that one down. Surprised I didn't see a three there from Wittenbaugh. Wittenbaugh's really let the three fly more this year than she did last year.
Yeah, I am too, especially
with how open she was.
Yeah, and with, you know, all the stats and stuff, analytics talking about, as the Duhawks get a steal here from Bachman.
That's a good one. And one.
And Bachman does lead the team in steals with 57. She had another one right there. But going back to Wittenbaugh, like when she dribbled down, I was kind of surprised with the analytics and everything, talking about the mid-range, how it's such a bad shot, and how you should either be like at the rim or shoot a three, really.
Yeah,
but proving people wrong there,
yeah,
draining that.
So Wittenbaugh is currently third in the ARC for steals per game. She came in today averaging just under three at 2.9 steals per game. Excuse me, Sierra Bachman is averaging 2.9 steals a game. It's going to be foul on Haslow. Duhawks leading 18-3 with just under 3.5 minutes in this first quarter.
And honestly, it seems like Duhawks are up by more than 15.
Haslow, good hustle, and she just threw that one back out of bounds.
At the start of the game, kind of seemed like the Duhawks were a little flat at the start, and now they've really picked up the energy here.
Mm-hmm.
And this 15-point lead kind of seems just a little bit bigger than that. Maybe like, I don't know, it feels like a 25-point lead. I mean, just this defense is swarming.
Yeah, it's a lot of great communication, a lot of good rotations. That's a good touch there from Fleck to get it out. Martin's going to lead the break.
Yeah, I think the pass there for Avery Holiday would have been a bounce pass, ideally, instead of trying to throw that one up there, which is why she turned it over.
Yep, and Holiday's going to bring it back up again. Bachman on her. Prairie Wolves just trying to get something to fall here for them. Still only sitting at 3 points in this quarter. But, again, with this Duhawks squad, they are really, like I said, playing a lot of swarm defense right now and a lot of good rotation. That's another steal from Bachman. She's going to have a nice, easy left-hand lay.
Surprised Coach Bullock hasn't called another timeout here. This team hasn't scored in a very long time.
Mm-hmm. It's a good touch there from Urell. It's going to be a 10-second call.
That was more than 10 seconds,
yeah,
too.
Great.
The shot clock's at 18.
Yeah, great pressure by the Duhawks.
Yeah, I think if Wesley could just break this press a little bit easier, it'd make their lives a lot better here, as that's been the main problem for them, is they haven't been able to get the ball across half court.
Mm-hmm.
When they do get across half court, they get all sped up and try and shoot in a hurry.
Duhok's working around Bachman. Haslow's pass tip, but Thiele able to get it. She'll pull it.
Oh, the bank
is open on a Saturday, folks.
From about the in between the wing and the corner, too. Yeah. It's a interesting. You don't really see that too much.
No, not at all.
But Hannah does lead the team in three-point attempts. That was her 112th of the season. She's shooting right around 30% from back there as well. It's a tough step back.
Yeah, Anna Lundahl, she checked in for the first time today. But, yeah, like we said with Ellie Barrows, Hannah Thiele's the exact same way. She's not afraid to pull it from deep.
You know, like the great Dion Waiters once said, he's like, I'd rather go 0-15 than 0-3 because then that means I lost confidence.
Yep.
Just got to keep letting them fly.
Gets to get past Thiele. Thought about it. Drove baseline. Good defense there. Bachman looking where to go with it. 7 seconds on the shot clock.
Movement.
Great ball movement. Fleck from three. No good. Sammy Martin. Can't come down with the rebound. Lundahl able to get it. Pass up to Denton. She's going to try to get something going here. Try to kick to the corner, but good touch from Bachman. And
tough.
That layup's good.
The tough layup there. Off balance and going through two lowest defenders. I think the key for the Duhawks here is what we saw last possession.
Good,
you get to the
skip.
High post.
It's just off right. Martin, good offensive board. Fleck, Bachman, she'll shoot that one. No good.
Got a push on, looks like it was number 40, Hannah Vandenack. And what has worked for the Duhawks these past couple of possessions is that high post touch as Haslow's going to shoot free throws because the defense is just swarming in on it. And the corner, the people guarding the people in the corners just sink in a lot there. And then you just got to use your vision and find the corner like we saw the past two possessions.
Yeah, definitely. And for Nebraska, they're just, like I said, they're really letting – mm-hmm. Loris really just take those threes. Loris coming into today was only a 27% three-point shooting team. So they're really trying to get rid of that middle because they know Sammy Martin loves to take it down low and finish out the rack.
Yeah, that's a good thing about Sammy. She can make a lot of plays. Oh.
Should be a foul called on Fleck. That's going to be her first.
Kind of surprised there's a foul call there, but the thing about Sammy is she doesn't just need to score for herself. She makes everybody else around her better because the amount of attention she gets.
Yeah, yep.
And she's not selfish to, like, pass the ball or anything as you see her diving on the ground and stuff.
It's going to be a jump ball. Possession arrow is for
Lutes, though, Prairie Wolves.
Scoreboard says Prairie Wolves. Table says Duhawks, and
no, the table
it'll
says
be for the
Prairie Wolves.
Prairie Wolves.
And in the gym right now, you can quite literally hear everybody talking on the floor.
Yeah,
right,
right on
now.
The court. Yep. And that'll do it for the first quarter. Duhawks up by 20, 25-5. Hugh, what's your takeaway so far after this first one?
For the Duhawks, obviously, you know, you're up by 20. There's nothing really to critique there. I mean, just keep putting the ball in the hoop, and that's how you'll win this game if you don't, like, self-implode on yourselves or anything. And then for Nebraska Wesleyan, just score the ball, really, is what I would have to say, is 5 points. Just got to score the ball to win, and defense, I'd probably start focusing. I mean, you can't really focus just on one player for the Duhawks on defense because they've been spreading the ball around. And,
And
like, it's not like Sammy has, like, 10 points in that quarter or anything. It's been spread out pretty well.
Yeah, and like you said, I mean, this Duhawk offense, they just have a ton of weapons.
Yeah.
With Sammy, Fleck, Bachman, really, it's just all over. But, I mean, for the Prairie Wolves, attempted 10 shots, only two of them got into falls, like you said. Just managing to get that ball dropped through the bucket. It's definitely going to be a huge factor for them. And it is Sierra Bachman. Bachman leading the DuHawks with 5 points after that first quarter. Sammy and Fleck both right behind her with four.
Yeah, and in that first quarter, the DuHawks, they lost in the rebounds 8-5, but the turnovers is where they is what really killed Wesleyan that first quarter. They had 10 turnovers to the DuHawks one, and that just kills you. And the DuHawks had 19 points off those turnovers, so almost getting a bucket off each turnover.
Yeah.
And as a coach, that's just what you hate, is points off turnovers.
Yep.
I know my high school coach always said he'd rather have a dead ball turnover than a live ball turnover.
Yep.
That was a good attack there.
Good attack. That layup unable to go.
I think that's what Wesley needs to do a little bit more. Just kind of try and push the pace like the DuHawks just did right there on them.
Yeah, absolutely.
But Denton just drove right through the middle of the DuHawk defense and had a pretty nice floater at the front of the rim.
Yeah, just a little too quick on it. But then an unbelievable baseball pass, full court pass from Haslab down to Bachman. Bachman, super quick, able to catch that. Lundahl, not good, and that one's good.
DuHawk switched to a zone there.
Partridge gets that one to fall.
And Partridge is listed at 6'4 as well, which it doesn't. I don't know if that's true or not.
Yeah, I see it. Ruben, good closeout. Flex three, that's good.
She could. Sammy's on her, so that's about a 4-inch difference, 3-inch listed wise. So I'd kind of look for them to try and maybe go for that. I think that's why the coach Ball put her in to try and get something going down low in the paint and then open up the three pointers.
And Denton right there. Denton just had that unfortunate turnover to give the DuHawks back the ball. Oh, Denton almost looked like she didn't know she was on
defense. Looks like Wesleyan's at a 3-2 here.
Yeah. You got three guards up. Again, that's really going to – Martin, 15-footer. That one's good.
Yeah, that's a good find there by Haslau once again, especially in zones. That's when you really want to get into that high post because then that opens up even more.
Oh good
steal.
Cookies. Haslau, nice poke. Easy layup.
And Coach Hines is keeping the press on, and Wesleyan is just keeps giving it to the DuHawks. Oh,
Haslau misses that one, but she gets her own rebound, gets out in the fall, and there's that timeout from Bullock.
Haslau's got a little smile on her face. Just patting the stats a little bit, Adam. I mean, why not? It's 36-7 as Wesleyan calls another timeout.
Yeah. Nebraska Wesleyan really just, like you said earlier, they just are unable to get it past half court. But that's props to the DuHawk defense. A lot of pressure. They're really making it tough for Nebraska Wesleyan to really do anything in that backcourt and even the front court when they get it down onto that DuHawk side.
Yeah. And as a coach, when you're down by 29 with 8 minutes left to go in the first half, you know, it's different if they're out. It's different if they have more talent than you, but when you get outworked, I know that's what coaches hate, is when they're out-hustling you and stuff like that. I know that's what coaches really despise. So I'd look for Wesleyan to come out with a little energy out of that timeout here. I think it'd help them out a lot here and just make better passing decisions on this press, like not get rushed in this trap.
Yep. There we go. On Nebraska Wesleyan, they're going to be able to get across there.
She might have had Partridge down low on the run.
We're going to find Barros. If Barros is going to step out of bounds, that there is an unfortunate turnover. And Barros back in,
She's going to let that fly,
too. Wouldn't be surprised if we start seeing her check up some threes here. Rose, a good skip to Urel. Oh, good heavy drive and good find to Martin. Martin's just going to go to work, and I believe that's going to be Partridge with the foul, and Martin's going to go to the line for two.
That was a good job by Urel to wait for for Partridge to come out and try and guard her, and then just use her quickness, knowing that Partridge is taller than her, and then just go right past her and find Sammy down low.
Absolutely. And now Wittenbaugh and Fleckenstein coming back into the game, and Martin's first free throw no good. Martin only a 64% free throw shooter coming into today.
And she leads the team in attempts as well.
That puts Duhawks up 37-7. Good trap here from Wittenbaugh and Fleck, but let's put
good
the
pass.
D and turnover again. Wittenbaugh. Rosick's there. Layup no good.
That was a great pass by Bach.
It was.
Good,
it
smart
really was.
Bounce pass.
Here's Halliday. Looking around, scanning options. Morozic on her. Partridge with the screen. They're going to kick over to Barros.
He walks in a zone here as well. 2-3. Partridge, not, I don't think she was overly happy she didn't touch the ball there. She was kind of calling for it when she had.
Yeah, she had a
Fleckenstein on her.
Yeah.
Which I think she had her sealed too, as Partridge checks out.
And
Carly
Vegas is checking in.
Adam from your home state of Colorado.
So I'm talking about.
Couple Colorado people on this roster for Wesleyan.
Yep, and Barrow's right here. One of them, her three, no good. Martin looking around to go. She's going to just Wittenbaugh. There's a three from Wittenbaugh. That one just off to the right.
And after that break, Wesleyan's played good defense.
Yeah.
Not letting the Duhawks get a whole bunch.
Absolutely.
Just a free throw. And, well, that's back-to-back in that corner.
Those are, for a team, those are the turnovers you just you just can't have. That's just – just not aware of your surroundings. Mm-hmm. Those ones are the ones that really hurt a lot to your team as far as turnovers, because those are ones that can easily be managed to not happen.
Yeah. Just a brain fart.
Yeah. Meg Murr's back in. Morozic looking where to go with it. She gives it down to Wittenbaugh.
I'd kind of like to see the Duhawks like post up on this 3-2.
Good
down
find.
Low.
Urel bumping and weaving through. Morozic. Just rims in and out. Here's Barros with Fleck on her. Barros kick over Skelton. Barros mid-range, and she's long on that one.
There's a lack of communication there on the Duhawks in that zone. Both Wittenbaugh and Meg Murr were trapping the same person up high.
Meg Murr, yeah, there it is.
And then that left Barros just wide open for that mid-range.
Yep. That was Meg Murr's first three this season. That's going to be a block. Ooh. Fleck might have been in that restricted area.
She might have got the wind knocked out of her a little bit, too.
That's going to put Skelton at the line. That should be Fleck's second.
Kind of surprised. Coach Heinzen's leaving her in here with two fouls and 5:23 left to go here still. But that's him trusting his senior leader to play smart and not pick up her third.
And Skelton's free throw no good. Second one is good for Skelton. Ali Udelhoffman's going to be checking in for the first time tonight.
Yeah, I think that's a smart decision, taking Fleck and sign out here. Jarrell, Jarrell's wide open
there. From
there.
Wittenbaugh.
I mean, right there, all five black jerseys were just surrounding the ball on Wittenbaugh there, so she made it, and she could have passed it to literally anybody.
Yep. Beyer going to just dish it down. Urel with a pump fake. I almost think that pump fake might have messed her up on that layup.
As well. One more.
Urel skip pass, fire three, bang.
Yeah, and that skip pass is going to be open all day on their zone. They shift very heavy to ball side.
Yep.
And they're almost going over the lane as they throw it right to Byard.
Yep. Jayhawks up 47-8 and still bringing on all this pressure.
That was a good job there by Wesleyan breaking that press.
Mm-hmm. Good skip to Skelton. Skelton's going to give it in. Villegas kick out. Three, no good. Urel with the rebound.
Not a lot of numbers here for the Dewhawks, but Byard we'll take a wide open
again.
Three.
Villegas coming down with that rebound. She's going to give it over to Hoagland.
Yeah, and those transition threes are something that you're starting to see become more and more accepted. Maybe not so much in high school, but when you get to the college level as – oh,
Egmer,
a little too far.
A little too far.
I think the court monster might have got her there, line.
Yeah.
Volleyball line came
volleyball
up and tripped
her. Came out of nowhere.
But that's kind of something you started to see when Steph Curry, Klay Thompson, those Warriors, the Splash Brothers were born. That's when you started to see all those transition threes. That was a good defense there by Bachman. And just active hands, just as active as her feet.
Yeah.
She's always moving them. That's a key for defense.
Yeah, hence it's a big reason why she is third in the conference in steals.
I mean, right there, she's tipping. And the hustle, too.
Hustle, she gets it in to Byard, and Byard's going to lead the break. Pass up to Wittenbaugh.
Good lead pass.
The ball movement, unbelievable.
I was just about to say that ball movement was beautiful to watch.
Now Udelhoff is going to go to the line for two. Udelhoff in an 80% free throw shooter, 16 of 20 on the year.
And Sammy Martin's due to check in for her if she makes both her free throws. Or not even both, the second one. So that's given the Dewhawks a 40-point lead.
Udelhoffen knocks both down. Like I said, Martin's going to come in for her.
Coach Hines and
going to bring four back. He's going to keep Sierra up in that backcourt, put a little pressure, but not have as much. So they're going to bring a trap, though, in certain areas.
It's going to call jump ball.
I believe that's Bandonak come back in. No, excuse me, that is Davis checking back in. Skelton up top, swings over to Hoagland, and that's going to stay here. It was tipped by Urel.
I mean, the Dewhawks are even guarding 6 feet
playing
above
up. Yeah, they are.
The 3-point line.
Oh, good touch there from Thiele, but that's going to stay here. Nebraska Wesleyan ball. Yeah, they really are. They're putting a lot of pressure in.
And that's part of the reason why Nebraska Wesleyan can't really get in the paint. They're having to take these threes because they just can't get past them. And, I mean, there's 5 seconds on the shot clock right now.
Mm-hmm.
Oh.
Hoagland from deep. That's just long. Whoa.
Yeah. A foul there on number 15, Breely Miller.
Thiele in the left wing, looking around, brings it up back up top to Bachman, Urel, skip. Dewhawks just moving it around well right now. Urel thought about it. She drives in. Good skip to Thiele. Haslow feeds Martin. Martin's going to try to go to work.
Up with it.
It's called a 3-second violation on Martin.
Yeah, and the Dewhawks haven't really been able to get a shot they want when the ball movement slows down. Because when they're moving it around quickly, just gets Nebraska Wesleyan out of place, and they're going, just going wherever the ball's going and not really anticipating a pass.
Yep.
Which the Duhawks have hit him on that skip pass, so I kind of look for the bottom defender of that 3-2 to start maybe cheating over a little bit to get to the corner a little bit faster.
Right.
Find Martin. Oh, there it
yeah,
is.
Like right there.
Good skip. Thiele unable to knock it down, but Urel's there for the rebound. Pass just a little bit off. Oh. Get right into the gut of Hoagland.
Yeah, but right there, the corner was so open because the Duhawks put another player down low in the post, and then Davis had to go over there. And Hoagland just kind of fell asleep, which left Thiele open.
Yeah.
You don't really see the 3-2 zone run a whole bunch either.
No, not a lot. Not a whole lot. It's more just like if you're playing a zone, it's more of a 2-3, if anything.
Yeah.
You travel.
Yeah, I think she thought about that one just a little bit too much there.
Yep. Rabel's going to bring this one up, swing it over, movement, and Thiele there, able to get a hand on it. Hoagland, 15-footer, long. Nebraska Wesleyan, I mean, they're getting, Nebraska Wesleyan getting a lot of good looks, just unable to get really any of them to drop right now.
Yeah, that's just the way it goes sometimes.
Yep, only shooting 16% from the field and 11 from deep. Hawkman starting the offense. Thiele thought about giving it in. She does give it to Martin. Good cut from Thiele. She's going to draw the foul and go to the line for two. First one good.
That's just her fourth free throw attempt of the year. Which kind of proves that she's really out there to shoot threes for the Duhawks.
Yep, she uses their shooter for big time.
And only 20 of her field goal attempts have been inside the arc as well on the year.
Wesleyan doing a good job moving around.
It's a good screen.
It's going to be a foul. Flores wanted to travel there.
Yeah, Thiele just kind of gave the ref a stare after that call.
That's Wesleyan trying to get something to fall here as they trail 51-8, but Martin able to get another touch on it, give another steal for the Duhawks, and Urel misses the layup, but Thiele's there, just put it back.
Yeah, and even if Sammy didn't get that steal right there, Haslow, I believe that's who was on the backside, would have just gone right over and taken it because Sammy was front. Oh!
Oh, Davis started going to the bucket a little too soon. Got right through her hands, but then hit off her, hit off Martin, and it'll stay Nebraska ball, and Meg Merle will check back into the game.
Kind of looks like Sierra Bachman's coming off. I don't know if she's just holding her hands up there to get some airflow or if there's something
tweaked
wrong with
the
her neck.
Yeah. Denton, three-pointer. That's long.
8 seconds left here. Oh, good cut.
Good cut, and that one goes at the buzzer. And the Duhawks will go into the half with a 55-8 lead after two quarters. Sierra Bachman.
After that play, the girls on the Nebraska Wesleyan bench just put their all their hands in their heads.
And that makes Thiele, I believe, the leading scorer for the Duhawks with Bachman, Martin, and Fleck all trailing her with 7. Hugh, takeaways from the first half for the Duhawks.
For the Duhawks, I mean, nothing really to critique. You're up by almost 50, not allowing, only allowing single digits in that first half. So what I would tell the players as a coach is to not let up. I mean, yeah, you're up by 47, but the game's not over yet. You still got 20 minutes to play, and just go out there with the same energy. And then for Wesleyan, it would be come out with even more energy.
Yeah, I mean, like we said, they're getting good shots. They're just not falling. So hopefully in the second half we can see some of them fall.
Yeah.
But, again, Duhawks leading 55-8 after the first half. Got 14 minutes on the clock. We'll be right back. And welcome back to Lillis Court here in the AWC at Loras College. Again, I am Adam Rodriguez, and joining with me is Hugh Molony. We saw the Duhawks with an impressive first half, leading 55-8 over the visiting Nebraska Wesleyan Prairie Wolves. Just some first half leaders for the Duhawks. Hannah Thiele leading the squad with 9 points. And right behind her, Sammy Martin and Madison Fleckenstein, both with 7. They are really, like you said, just dominating this game right now. And it, unfortunately for Nebraska Wesleyan, after the first half, they had 23 turnovers. Definitely a big factor into how this game has been going.
Yeah, and the Duhawks' points off turnovers is 35.
Yeah, so just over like half of their points are coming from the Nebraska Wesleyan turnovers, and so we'll see if Nebraska Wesleyan can turn some of those turnover woes around.
Yeah, and we were talking at halftime, wondering when Coach Heinzen is going to kind of maybe rest the starters a little bit.
Yeah, and I think we're seeing right now.
That's what we're seeing right now. Yep. Claire Wagner
blocked there. So this first line for the Duhawks is Lexi Beyer, Meg Murr, Claire Wagner, Cassie Morozik, and Allie Bronson. Wagner and Bronson both making their first appearances today, and Meg Murr with a nice steal there. She's going to get a break going.
That was a good play, especially on the bigger defender.
Wagner's layup no good. And Bandinet coming down with that rebound.
Duhawks are out in here, and man, switching up from the end of last half, and they're in the 2-3 zone.
Wire comes away with that steal. But Nebraska Wesleyan able to get it back and go in for the layup, but it's no good. Bandinet coming down with the offensive rebound. Duhawks just moving it around. Egmer swings over to Morozik. Morozik thought about it. She drives baseline, but Bandinet gave it there. Good cross pass.
Tough pass.
Yeah. Bronson corner, no good on the shot, but she will shoot 2 free throws here.
Yeah, that's a good move right there from Brunson to get past the defender. And then still, even though she got fouled, still made a pretty good attempt at the shot.
Yeah, that foul's going to be called on Holtquist, and Brunson makes that first one.
She's now 10 of 11. On the year from the free throw line.
Number 12.
Look at us. 2 math magicians out here.
Denton bringing it up for the Prairie Wolves. Going to try to get something here and hopefully get them get another point on the board for the Prairie Wolves. But as we said, it's just been all Duhawks offensively and defensively in this game. Claire Wagner tried to save it in, just kind of threw it to no man's land. Nebraska Wesleyan, that shot's no good.
It's
going to be a foul on Murray.
Yeah, I'm kind of surprised. To me, from up here at least, it looked like a clean box out.
Yeah, if anything, and I thought it was just like a height difference with Fanta,
yeah,
like being able to grab that rebound. But nonetheless, that's Murray's second foul. But then Murray almost came away with a steal there. And layup good by Ellie Breen.
And for Wesleyan, part of the reason they just now got to 10 points is they're struggling just to make entry passes down low in the post. Mm-hmm. And when you can't make a pass, you oftentimes cannot score.
Yep.
Fire. Good ball movement.
Murray's three. That's good. Murray with their second shot attempt.
And their second three
two
of the
for
year.
Two. Yeah.
Second three of the year. I mean, why not get hot real quick? Start letting them fly.
Claire Wagner coming over the steal. She gives up to Murray. Murray's going to – good pass there. To lead Byer. And Byer's going to go up and under. Nice little reverse.
Nice play.
Yeah. Just a great – great push there. Duhawks now up 62-10. Rest Wesleyan just trying to moving it around here. Bandinek setting the screen. Good pick and roll. Good kick out. Denton for three. No good. Rosa comes down with that rebound.
Well, she's getting held too on that board.
And Murray skip pass. Oh, good find.
Deep.
Lexi's three, no good. But Brownson, no one around her, able to get the rebound, and she gets hacked hard. She's going to go to the line for two more.
Yeah, just good awareness by Brownson. I mean, nobody around her. We get a
whole five switch. Yeah. It's going to be Udelhoffen coming back in. Tess Johnson checking in for the first time. Megan Stapleton checking in for the first time. Kylie Rigby also coming in for the first time. And then I believe it's going to be Wittenbaugh coming in for Bronson after the...
It's like a line change, like in hockey.
Yeah. It's exactly what it is. Both those are good for Allie. Russ Wesley moving in around. Duhawks, I believe they're in a 2-3 again. Foul on Udelhoffen. They're going to say she wrapped around.
And she looks kind of confused on the call. And Coach Heinzen, he doesn't look overly happy with the crew that he had out there.
Yeah, not entirely sure, but yeah, Udelhoffen, I thought it was just like a fine box out and then she went to the ball, but the ref said she might have had a little just wraparound hook behind her. But
that was a really quick talk
from Heinzen.
And I think he maybe said five words. I think his look kind of said the rest for him.
Rusk Wesleyan inbound down low. Davis got it with Udelhoffen guarding her. Hogan driving left on Stapleton. Floater, no good, just long. I feel like that's a common tendency right now with this Nebraska team. I feel like a lot of their shots have been long, maybe just because they're maybe not just slowing down enough to really get that shot off. But good steal there from the Prairie Wolves. Barrow's going to bring it up, looking where to go with it. Kick out. Three, no good from Villegas. Rigby's going to bring the ball up.
Yeah, and I think...
Ooh, pass on the stolen there. Stable table. Good skip to Tess Johnson. Her three, just short.
Yeah, I think maybe why Coach Heinzen is so upset. Because Duhawks kind of seem lack of focus here.
Yep.
This group that just came in kind of don't seem overly focused or locked in. Maybe not taking... You know, you're up by 54, so maybe they're not going their hardest.
As hard as they should be.
Which I think is kind of upset Heinzen a little bit.
Stapleton's going to pass it in. There's Rigby's going to move it around. She's going to start the play here. Swings over to Johnson.
Got to get a high post touch.
There it is. Wittenbaugh going to try to go through it. Stapleton looking around.
Ooh, that was a risky pass. Could easily have been stolen.
Johnson finds you off in short corner.
I think Wittenbaugh should have cut there when little Udelhoffen was in the short corner like she should right here.
Got to get a shot up. Just going to be a quick
one. Wesleyan just foul. Wesleyan bailed him out there.
Big time.
That was number 30, Lundahl, I believe is who it's on. Yep. Lundahl, excuse me. But, yeah, if I'm personally, I don't think Wittenbaugh should just be sitting or standing where she was in the high post when Udelhofen touches it down low in the short corner. She should cut.
Oh, exactly.
And then it opens up way more for the offense. And we've seen the Duhawks do it numerous times where they get a wide-open layup off of a cut from the
and
high post.
It's there, too, because like every time a ball goes anywhere near the bucket, it's almost like all five swarm it. So, like you said, that cut, we've seen it. It's going to be there for sure. Stapleton, three-pointer, no good.
That was a pretty good shot, too.
That was a good shot for sure. Well, it looked good from up here, yeah.
Good, nice spin and rotation on the ball and everything.
Rigby's going to inbound it here, just giving it up to Wittenbaugh. Good drive from Rigby, getting a paint touch. Now the Duhawks just going to move it around. Tess, good dip.
Good.
Wittenbaugh three, good.
Good ball movement by the Duhawks, especially from Udelhofen to realize the double team was coming, and then before she could get swarmed, she got it out right when Nebraska Wesleyan was kind of in that no man's zone.
Yep.
She gets a block, too. Stat sheet stuffer.
Johnson leading the little break here. Udelhofen swinging over Wittenbaugh.
Oh, Rigby's not happy she did not get the ball in the corner there.
Yeah, she was pretty open there in that corner. An unfortunate turnover there. Barlow's going to try to do something here.
Yeah, and it was the right idea. Just not well executed. Didn't get enough on that pass there by Udelhofen for the cross court.
Krasko trying to just get another bucket. Still only 2 points here in this quarter. Not a bad idea there from Lundahl. Just happened to be, I think it touched off of Udelhofen's foot. But now we're going to have another switch. First five's going to come back in. Murray, Rosick, Bronson, Beyer, and Wagner. Another hockey substitution.
Line one, checking back in.
Yep.
Coming back onto the ice.
Good idea right there from the Prairie Wolves. Just an unfortunate pass. Just a little too much on the pass to the roll.
It would have had a mismatch there as well because I believe Wagner was the one for the Duhawks coming over.
Mm-hmm.
And it would have been Davis, who's listed at 6'1", and Wagner listed at 5'10". So definitely would have been a good chance for the Prairie Wolves to score there.
Byers three, no good. But you guys coming down with the rebound.
I'd look for them to start getting this ball to Partridge down low.
Yep. Kick over to Burrows. Burrows, three good.
It was a good job by Partridge. Using her height there when the Duhawks double and almost triple teamed her to just rise up above him and find the open shooter in the corner.
Yep, and that was Barrow's first three of the game. She's attempted four before that. None of them fail, and Morozic gets one to go.
Good job by Brunson, staying poised, the high post, and like we said all game, those high post touches is what has really killed Wesleyan besides the turnovers.
Yep. Paegas coming down with the offensive rebound. Barrow's going to let that one fly. No good. Wagner's coming down with the rebound. She's going to let Murray push it.
They got three on two.
Rosick again, no good. Wagner comes down with that rebound. She tried to go reverse and gets fouled by Lundahl.
Yeah, not really a smart foul there from Lundahl because I'm pretty sure the chances of that reverse layup.
I don't know if she was really
looking at the hoop and she was going up with it.
Yeah, definitely just an unfortunate foul, like you said. And Wagner's first one, no good.
A little too much spin on that one. That's just her third attempt on the year as well from the free throw line.
Second one, no good. Carlos comes down with that rebound. Swing.
There's a big mismatch down low with Partridge. Yeah, she was calling for it too.
Carlos wide open. Her three, no good. But Viega's coming down with the rebound. Just
it's good strength.
That height difference, too, over Morozic and Lundell's layup no good. Partridge there. Her.
I don't know why they're not giving the ball to Partridge more. She's already opened up the offense way more for them because you saw there Murray had to come down and double-team because of the height difference.
Yep. Bronson just kicks out Morozic's three. Good.
3 points. And Cassidy's hit a couple threes in this quarter alone, starting to kind of heat up a little bit.
Big time. Yeah, and we've seen her play a lot more recently, a lot more minutes recently. Mm-hmm. I mean, she would come into games early in the season but never really played a good amount. But lately we've seen her play quite a bit. And I think Heinzen just likes her to jack up some threes like we've been seeing here. Definitely a great shooter for this Duhawk squad.
One more.
Murr over to Byer. Three-pointer no good, but Wagner able to get in there.
Good offensive rebound.
But layup won't go. Partridge came down with that one. Lundell's going to push pace here. Barros from the corner. Good.
That was a good job by Barros floating down to the corner when she saw that her defender left her. Just good basketball IQ.
Good find for Murray to get Wagner cutting down to the bucket. Just wide open in the paint. Partridge, right hand layup. Good. Good find there.
I mean, she's arguably been the best player for Wesleyan so far today, and she hasn't even played that much.
Mm-mm, no, she. I mean, like you said, she's really allowing them to have more open opportunities throughout this third quarter.
Which I'm kind of surprised she hasn't played more in this game. I don't know if there's a if she's a little hurt or something, but.
Mm-hmm. 12 seconds left on the clock. 10. Bench gonna set their countdown. Murray thought about shooting that one. Oh, she gets it poked away.
Put it up.
Floater. Ah. All off of good, and she tried to get it back up, but no good. And at the end of three, the Duhawks lead it 75-23. Again, it's just pretty much been the same story this entire game. Just a lot of Duhawk pressure really making it hard for this Wesleyan team to get anything going. But we saw a good glimpse of something out of Nebraska Wesleyan. A lot more shots falling, especially for Barros from deep. I think we saw three from her that quarter, and like you just talked about, Partridge for sure. Big factor for this Nebraska Wesleyan success in that third quarter.
Yeah, and the Duhawks only outscored Wesleyan by 5 points in that quarter. Duhawks scoring 20, Wesleyan with 15. And that's kind of what we talked about at halftime was Wesleyan come out with just a little bit more energy because they almost doubled the amount of points they had in the first half there. And just in that one quarter.
Yep, absolutely. Yeah. But so Duhawks leading 75-23. And again, right after this will be the men's game versus Nebraska Wesleyan. And earlier in the season, a very close one with them. And even last year, we were on the call for the game last year. That was a very close game. That one should be
the senior day last year.
Another fun one. Yep, senior day. And it should be another fun one today between two very solid teams. And I mentioned it in the volleyball game earlier. A lot of people definitely got surprised by how this men's squad is doing this year. A lot thought it was going to be a down year after losing guys like Jake Healy, Rowan McGowan, and Cole Navigado losing that big three. But
I mean, Ali Sabet has
been
like
doing
must-watch basketball.
Yeah, he's
for not just like Duhawk fans, but like people of just fans of basketball, especially if you follow D3 very closely. Ali's a very fun player to watch. He's a very much get his buckets kind of guy.
Absolutely, yeah. So that, like you said, we see it quite a bit.
So crafty too.
Yeah, and they like to look to him for a lot of buckets late, and like, on that late of the shot clock too.
That UD game, I mean, he just went absolutely insane. I'm pretty sure he was around 30 points in that game, and he sealed it off with a nice three at the end.
Yep. Well, with that, I mean, they just got a lot of weapons on that squad. Yeah. Just between him, Tyler Bass having a great year. Only a sophomore, and T. Bass, so definitely for the Duhawks, that's going to be fun to have him for two more years as that's a travel there from Skelton. But definitely stick around for that game at starting at 4 o'clock. But that should be a very, very exciting one yet again.
Number 23 has checked in for the Dewhawks, Jesse Galaska, a freshman.
Stapleton, 15-footer no good, and Skelton comes down with that rebound.
Good job getting through the screen.
Yep. And Skelton just unable to hold on to that pass from Denton, and yet another turnover for the Prairie Wolves. That is now their... That was their 29th turnover of the game. Dewhawks moving
good
around
cut.
Well. Good cut there. Good move there from Alaska.
Dewhawks playing good defense still, especially on those screens. They're hedging just the right amount of time.
Yep, that's a good
and
poke
in the right
there.
Space.
That's a good poke from Tess Johnson. Tess Johnson going to push up the pace. Rigby down the corner. Where to go with it. She's finds Udelhoff into the top. She's going to give it to Yuloska. She's going to attempt a three. Good.
Good spacing.
Yeah, great spacing. Good ball movement there.
I mean, when you have good spacing, that's the keys. Dewhawks, I believe, it was a 4-out, 1-in there. And you have to have good ball movement when you're doing that, especially when you're in the high post. You got to make
Absolutely.
That turn to the hoop quick and then scan even quicker.
Without a doubt.
Oh, the deep three for the bank.
Rigby swings over to Johnson in the corner. That pass was touched. Rigby, 15-footer. That one's good for Rigby.
Right place, right time for Rigby. Got the pass getting deflected.
Oh, good hand there from Johnson. That's going to good wrap up for a jump ball. Westland's also going to make a nice hockey switch here. Davis, Barros, Villegas, Hoagland, and... Graham.
Kind of surprised Johnson let that ball go out, that she didn't grab it just to keep things moving.
Dewhawks moved around Murray to Morozic. Morozic, another three. No good, but Wagner, good follow and good layup.
And Wesleyan switched back to his zone there. They've been in man a lot in this in this second half. Usually when you're zone, it's easier for you to get those defensive rebounds. So just miscommunication once again for Wagner to get that wide open offensive rebound.
I guess came down with the rebound, but Meg Murray able to get a jump ball, and it'll go for the Dewhawks.
Back in that 3-2.
No, Dewhawks just moving it. Good, one more there for Meg Murray. Three, no good.
good use of the pick and roll.
Yep.
Hogan finding Davis. Davis gets back out. Hogan drives. It's going to be foul on Morozic. Hoagland at the line for two. First one in short, no good.
That was the first foul called this quarter as well. And we're almost over halfway. Excuse me.
Second one is good. Byer thought about that 15-footer. She finds Megan Murray. Oh, Murray almost traveled. Finds Morozic. Morozic should knock that one down.
And she's playing well in this fourth quarter. She is. Blue Hawks.
That should make her the leading scorer for this Duhawks squad.
Yeah, it is. She's got 11.
11.
She's 3-6 from the three-point line as well.
Good defense there from Murray. Hoagland driving left. Shot no good. Brunson's going to come down with the rebound. Wagner, Rosick driving left to left. Going to be a double.
She didn't know if she wanted to pass that one or go up with it. Because it looked like she was going to throw it to the corner, which was where Beer was.
Duhawk still playing very good pressure defense here. Good poke there from Murray. Rosick's going to get a fast break. That layup's no good. Hogan came down with that rebound. Nebraska Wesleyan's going to get something going here.
Hawks back in that man defense. Been switching it up a lot in the second half.
Oh, Vallejo's three blocked. It'll stay here.
It's almost like she was walking away like
she thought that was
yeah.
Johnson, Rigby, Stapleton, Udelhoff, and Anuleska all back in. Partridge shot blocked by Udelhoffen. Fast break. Lead pass from Johnson a little too far, but Tess is going to get a three and short, but Udelhoffen there to rebound.
It was a pass. It wasn't a three. It was a pass. I mean, me personally, if Udelhoffen would have scored off that, I would have gave her the assist.
The assist, yeah. Johnson ready to go with it. She finds Stapleton. Stapleton's going to shoot a three. No good. But Udelhoffen able to get the rebound. Oh, through the legs to Rigby. Good drive. That's going to be a foul. It's going to be a foul on Alexa back. First one, no good. Second one, good. We're just under 3 minutes left in women's basketball. With the Duhawks leading 88-27. Rigby drive left corner. Uleska thought about it. She's going to drive right.
Oh,
Udelhoffen didn't look like she was ready for it.
That was kind of a hard pass for how close they were as well. A lot of heat on that one.
Yeah, the idea definitely was there.
I mean, she could have gone up with that, too, if she wanted to. Good rip through.
And it's going to be a foul on Udelhoffen. And Partridge is going to be going to the line.
For her 11th and 12th free throw attempts on the year.
Partridge no good on that one.
And she's not really happy with herself for missing that one.
Archer's second one is good.
Yeah, and Partridge is the leading scorer for the Prairie
Wolves.
Good
cut from Johnson. And one!
Partridge only played 8 minutes, but she is leading Wesleyan in points and rebounds. She has 5 rebounds and 7 points. She leads Wesleyan with points, which is, like I said earlier, I'm surprised she's only played 8 minutes so far. She probably finished close to 10 with 1:47 left here.
Oh, turnaround jumper good. Bradley Miller. Rigby is going to put a little pace on this here, push it up court.
Oh, step back.
Oh, good. And Partridge able to come down with that rebound after that Yulaska miss. Lundell thought about it. Partridge finds Lundahl. Her shot is no good.
Good rebound.
Good rebound there for Miller. Johnson getting a hand. And there. Here's Graham looking around. Lundahl swings it over the back. Good idea there from Graham. Just a bad placement of that pass, but Udelhoffen able to get that steal.
She kind of got away with a little bit of a push there, too.
Good pivot. 15-footer, no good, and back able to get that rebound. And with 35 seconds left on the clock, the Duhawks will move to 19-4 and 12-2 in conference play. And as for the Prairie Wolves, they will fall to 6-16 and 2-12 in conference play. Both teams will be back in action on February 15th, this upcoming Wednesday. Rask Wesleyan will be at home against Simpson College. And as for the Duhawks, they will travel up the road to the rival University of Dubuque what should be another exciting game.
I know I'll be there.
Loris put on a good showing against University of Dubuque when UD came over to us, but that should be a very exciting game. And Loris will close this one out with a 91-30 victory over the Prairie Wolves.
February 15th, day after Valentine's Day, too.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
So why not spend some time with your loved ones watching some Loris basketball?
Absolutely, and make sure, definitely mark that one down in your calendars again. Great rivalry, and that will be an excellent game. But for sure, stick around for the men's action between the Loris College Duhawks and the Rask Wesleyan Prairie Wolves. Myself and Hugh will be on that call, and we will catch you guys then.